It's the first Rugby League Cup final of 2005. It's the Northern Rail Cup final at Blackpool, and two clubs with a glorious past aim for a more promising future. It's the Castleford Tigers against Hull Kingston Rovers. Now then, you think of Blackpool and you think of the world-famous tower. Mind you, they also enjoy a ride on the big one here. You go from the top of the world to the bottom in just a couple of seconds. And the fans of two famous old clubs hope that they will be on top of the world tonight, hoping that this will be the start of something big. It is a complete and utter sellout here at Bloomfield Road in Blackpool, home to the Blackpool Panthers from National League Two. Blackpool is suddenly back on the rugby league map. Hello, welcome to Bloomfield Road, and this here is what all the fuss will be about over the next 80 minutes, the Northern Rail Cup final, and the two famous old clubs here who are taking part in today's final. Well, the last time they met when silverware was at stake was in 1986 at Wembley for the Challenge Cup final, and Castleford, the underdogs that day, they beat Hull Kingston Rovers by 15 points to 14. The Robins had just ended a wonderful era where they won back-to-back league titles, but it was Castleford's day at Wembley. They picked up the trophy. Since then, of course, the Tigers, well, they were ever present in the Super League until they were relegated at the end of last season, 2004. Sadly, Hull Kingston Rovers have been out of the limelight recently. They haven't been amongst the elite since 1994. So the supporters of these two sides here today hoping for something to celebrate at the end of the next 80 minutes. And it's a pleasure to welcome the Whitehaven coach, Steve McCormack, who is here with Steve-O and me to build up to the kickoff here in about 10 or 15 minutes' time. Steve, first of all to you, the 15th of May this year, Castleford Tigers 32, Hull Kingston Rovers 26 in the National League One. Does that necessarily mean that Castleford start as favourites today?
No, I don't think so. I think if you look at the recent results, what Hull KR have had, they're playing some fantastic rugby. Castleford, I think, will just start slight favourites because of the consistency with the results throughout the year so far. But you know, I think it's going to be a great game. Probably both form teams in the division at the moment, and you know, they've got everything to play for. It's a cup final. You know, the build-up's probably been great. The supporters here, they've come out in the numbers, and I think we're in for a great game.
Well, it should be, because if we think back to the grand finals we've had in the National Leagues recently, they have been terrific contests. But I've looked at the records over this season. Hull Kingston Rovers were beaten by Whitehaven by 51 points to nil. Whitehaven, the last team to beat the Robins then, but since then they've been on a run of seven unbeaten. So what do you think, really? I mean, who is the form team coming into this?
Well, Hull KR probably are the form team. They had a great result last week. I think they beat Featherstone by 70 points, and confidence is a wonderful thing in this game. You know, since that defeat at Whitehaven, you know, we played really well that day, and you know, they changed the coach. They've had a few changes at Hull KR. James Webster's filled in as player coach, and you know, he's really relished in that challenge. So confidence-wise, Hull KR can't be any higher than that. Castleford coming off the back of a defeat last week, you know, and confidence is a marvellous thing in this game. You know, if you're confident, you can play well. You know, last week's performance by Castleford, you know, you never know, it could play on the minds, and if Hull KR start well, then you never know what could happen.
Yes, they were beaten by Rochdale Hornets last week for the first time in the National League One, the Castleford Tigers. But still, they are everybody's favourites to get up to Super League. And Steve-O, when you look at the history of this competition over the past few years, the teams that generally have won this, Huddersfield, Salford and Lee last year, they have then gone on to get into the Super League at the Grand Final. So should the winner here today start planning already for Super League 11, do you think?
Well, of course, the consistency, as you've shown, is that they will be thinking and be very, very confident of making it into Super League. But it doesn't always work that way, does it? You know, this is a cup final. Shocks do occur. There's not much between these two sides. And I think I mentioned on Boots and All last Wednesday that never mind the Northern Rail Cup, it can be a tin cup, it could be an egg cup. It is important that one of these sides lifts the trophy for not only just the glory, but also for the merchandise that they will be selling. And maybe more important than that is the fact that their sales for next season, they'll already be queuing at the door. And that's important financially. We all know that in the professional game that you've got to get as much money as you can, especially if you're preparing for Super League. That is important as well, because you're only going to entice bigger and better players into your side to take on Super League the following year. if you can entice them with a lot of money. And that is why it is important today, not only for the players, but also for the clubs themselves. It's not going to be easy. I feel to say that this Hull KR side, very strong in the forwards, and I think that Castleford, they will rely so much on Brad Davies. Here is the man that will just make their side tick, and there is little doubt in my mind that they will just close him down. KR will be pinpointing this guy. He will probably take the first receiver early in the game and then drift out, maybe taking the second receiver and trying to get the ball out wide, because the one thing that Castleford do have is this guy, Wayne Price. Always comes up with a natty hairstyle as this fella, and I must say he has the speed. There'll be no chance of pulling the hair out on this guy if he gets open space. Okay, well, as I say, I must say that they have the experience, and the fullback, Leroy Rivette, of course, four tries at Wembley. We all know what he's capable of. And it's in a different position, playing at fullback. Maybe that is a little bit of a gamble, but it's not alien to that position. He knows it, and of course, it will give him that extra space. And if he can get on the move, then I'm sure that if he can support the power in the forwards. I'm going to go for a little bit of an upset. I'm not going for the underdog. I think Hull KR with their forwards. I've always felt that when it comes down to the crunch, when you're in a cup final, it's all about real power and taking control. And I think that Hull KR's mighty six will do just that.
Well, Hull Kingston Rovers changed coaches in midstream not long ago. Harvey Howard left the club and Justin Morgan has moved in. He will actually be here today and he will take full control after the Toulouse Challenge Cup semi-final against the Leeds Rhinos in a couple of weeks' time. We're going to hear from him in a moment. But first of all, the man who has been in charge at the Castleford club since day one of the 2005 season. His name is Dave Woods, and he is on the sideline now with Ben Pro.
Dave, fair to say that injuries have disrupted both teams' preparation to this one. How's the Castleford preparation been?
Yeah, been very good. I don't think we could have prepared any better. We've had a really good week. You know, the last 2 days have been exceptional. Last night and yesterday was very good, and today I think the boys are focused and ready to go.
You edged out Hull KR earlier in the season in the National League One clash. Do you see that having any bearing on today's result?
No, not really. I think, you know, we've just got to make sure that we go out and play our footy and control the ball, and I'm sure it'll be a real tough game, and you know, we'll take a little bit out of that, but not much, because they're a quality side, Hull KR, and yeah, a new coach and all there now with Justin, and so they'll be out to impress, and I think it's going to be a top quality game.
Just in a massive day for Hull KR, how have preparations gone?
They've been really good, actually. We had a few injury scares earlier in the week, but everyone that we expected to play is on deck, and preparation's been good. We've certainly concentrated a little bit on Castleford, but more so on ourselves and completing our sets. But so far, the week's been very, very good. We've got a great day for rugby league, so very much looking forward to the day.
You've lost in this final twice before. Has that made the players more hungry for this one's success this time?
Well, maybe on a personal level, it's not something that we've really addressed, you know, as a group. You know, some of the players that may have been involved at the club, yeah, a little bit personally, but, you know, not collectively at all. We haven't really spoken about it. We're just trying to look forward like the club is doing on all aspects. So, you know, just concentrating on our own game, basically.
We mentioned the current form coming into this match. Castleford just one league defeat all year. Last time out against Rochdale, Bobby Goulding's drop goal proving crucial. Castleford lost by 17 points to 16. They are after, though, their first silverware in 11 years here today. And Hull Kingston Rovers, as Ben said to their new coach, Justin Morgan, it's their third appearance in this final in 4 years, and they have yet to win one, but they are bang in form. They beat Featherstone Rovers 78 points to 10 last week. Hull Kingston Rovers, around about 3,500 people here. Castleford's support, Steve McCormack, has held up remarkably well despite the fact that they dropped out of Super League. There are 6,000 fans here from Castleford today, and I think they could have sold the place two times over.
Yeah, that's fantastic support considering what happened last year. You know, it's very easy for fans to desert a club when they do get relegated, but I think the previous fixture between Hull KR and Castleford, I think there may have been, you know, over 8,000 people on that fixture as well. So, you know, both sets of supporters deserve a lot of credit, you know, especially the Castleford side. After what they've been through, to stick by the side like they have done deserves a lot of credit.
They do, because if you drop out of Super League, there was great dismay around the town of Castleford last year. The town has taken a few knocks as well. over the course of recent history, and for them to lose their ever-present tag in Super League and in the top flight of rugby league, that was a huge blow to the town. But they've bounced back well, haven't they?
Yeah, it was a massive blow because it's never happened to them. And you know, they're a great side. They've got a lot of tradition, the Castleford side. And as you said, sometimes a little bit of adversity to a club, you know, it makes them rebuild a little bit, just assess everything both on and off the field. And I'm sure Castleford's done that.
Some great names of the past who have played for these two clubs. Brian Lockwood and Roger Millwood played for both of them, Steve-O. You will know those two, of course. Other great names for Castleford: Malcolm Reilly, Dennis Hartley, more recently Lee Crooks, Kevin Ward and John Joyner. And for Hulkington Rovers, Flash Flanagan, Phil Lowe, David Watkinson and Len Casey. Two clubs here with a wonderful past. What about the future?
Well, they've got to push it to one side. It's as simple as that. I think that the crowd at Castleford have done exceptionally well. And also at Hulkington Rovers, of course, Phil Lowe, heavily involved with the club itself. They want to try to lift them back to the glory days. And I think it would really help, especially, you know, Hull have proved that they are the best in the town at the moment. But the Red and Whites, they are very, very keen to get back into the higher level. And also from Castleford, you mentioned all those great names, Eddie. But that will mean nothing to these guys. They are focusing on 80 minutes. They know how important it is. And the fans just love it. Whenever there's silverware, they just come out of the woodwork. As you said, they could have sold twice as many tickets for this game. I think it was 10 days ago that it was a full house announced. And you can't beat that when it comes to a final. It means that the enthusiasm is still there in the two towns. They will be fighting to go back. It's not definite. Just because they win today, it won't be definite they're going into Super League. But psychologically, it will be a huge lift for them, whoever wins today.
Absolutely, because as we said earlier, the three clubs who have previously won the trophy in all its guises, Salford, Huddersfield and Lee, they have made it into the Super League at the end of that season. Let's take a check on the men then who will do battle in this Northern Rail final here today. Castleford Tigers have got Michael Platt at fullback, and then they go Wayne Price, Dion Bird, Johnny Hepworth and Michael Shenton. And the standoff is Paul Hanforth, and the halfback, the evergreen Brad Davis. The forwards, Adam Watini. The hooker and captain is Andrew Henderson, and Andy Bailey is the other prop forward. Prop forward Bailey then, and the second rows, Tom Hockey and Craig Hubie, and the loose forward is Steve Crouch. And on the bench for Castleford, Andy Kane, Richard Fletcher, Byron Smith and Frank Watini, and the coach is Dave Woods. Now, the men from the Humber, from Hull Kingston Rovers, the city of Kingston upon Hull. We were at Hull last night, of course, for their match against Huddersfield, the black and whites. These are the red and whites on the other side of the city. Leroy Rivette is the fullback. Jonathan Steele, Kane Ipati, Gareth Morton and Byron Ford, the three quarter lines. Paul Manson and James Webster's the skipper. He's the scrum half. Up front, it's James Garmston, Andy Ellis and David Tangatatoa. The second row is Andy Raleigh and Jason Netherton, with Dale Holstock locking the scrum at loose forward. And the substitutes here for Hull KR: Paul Pickering, Dwayne Barker, Jamie Beauville, who was cleared to play by the disciplinary committee this week. He appealed against a one-match ban. It was successful, and he is allowed to take his place in the showpiece. And last but by no means least, Michaeli Aizu. And the coach is Justin Morgan. Great occasion bubbling up here. It's a glorious day, quite hot and sultry, despite the fact that it is cloudy overhead, but very, very warm indeed. And that will be a big test of these players, their fitness. We talked, Steve McCormack, about the fitness in Super League. How fit are these boys here?
Well, they've probably trained just as much as Super League. You know, I'm pretty sure that Hull KR, well, Castleford have remained full-time, so they'll do exactly what a full-time squad do, but Hull KR will probably train three, four, maybe five times a week as well. They've obviously just got jobs to go to, but I think that's a big factor today. I think the heat as well, I think the way Castleford play, they like to move the ball around. They've got a lot of pace, the back three in Shenton and Price and Platt. And the big thing's going to be the kick chase from Hull KR side. They're a big side, Hull KR, big forwards, and I'm pretty sure that Castleford are trying to move them around.
Okay, so there we are. The presentation's over and done with. The crowd all on their feet, all eager and anticipating a great Northern Rail Cup final. Up to the commentary box then. Steve-O's on his way up there to join Phil Clark. And first we'll hear from Bill Arthur.
It's a big day for young referee Ben Thaler from the Wakefield Society. By all accounts, he's been performing very well indeed in the National Leagues this season, but this cup final, a massive game for him, a massive game for these two sides. And Hepworth underway, and that could be out on the full, just dropping in the field of play and taken by Webster. And a very strong hit early on by the Castleford Tigers, showing their intent there.
You couldn't start the game with a better kickoff than that. Inch perfect, and the defence backed it up as well here. Hulker under a bit of pressure.
And Gareth Morton is immediately under pressure. Returning to rugby league from Borders Rugby Union, Morton saying he's delighted to be back, and he's only been back a few weeks and he finds himself in this hothouse atmosphere here at Bloomfield Road. And Hull Kingston Rovers, really the form side here, won the last seven while Cass are trying to come to terms with losing their unbeaten record in that defeat at Rochdale last time out. And Hull KR are also looking to make up for the fact that they've lost their previous two appearances in this, what is basically the National League Cup final. They've been beaten by Huddersfield and Lee previously, so they're hoping to make amends here. But it's the Castleford Tigers on the attack with Adam Watine. Be a powerhouse prop. And here is the veteran Brad Davis, 37 years old, putting the kick in and turning around Byron Ford, the Cook Islander, who's got great pace. But that's a good chase, led by Steve Crouch.
Well, I guess that's how Casper will want to start the game, as close to the Hull Kingston Rovers line as possible. Some great intensity and pace in the defensive line. They've made a very, very good start to the match.
Here's Leroy Rivette, another recent recruit to this Hull Kingston Rovers side, rescued from a pretty miserable time with Villefranche in the French competition. Morton is tackled. Here is James Webster, who's actually the acting coach at Hull KR at the moment. Justin Morgan yet to take over his duties. He's still technically in charge of Toulouse. Has that big Challenge Cup semi-final coming up against Leeds. And Webster has been a very successful acting coach. Unbeaten in five under him, our Hull KR. That's a good chase from Rovers from Webster's kick. Shenton. And Rovers now looking to apply the pressure up at that far end of the field. That is the Armfield stand, or it will be when they build something at that end of the ground. At the moment it's a bit of a wasteland, unlike the rest of this ground, which is coming on very nicely indeed here. But a stand to be named in honour of Jimmy Armfield down there. Here come Cass, looking to get the ball out wide to Wayne Price, and Price back in field from the pass from Johnny Hepworth. On halfway now, Davis stabs the kick in. And a good chase again by the Castleford Tigers.
Bill, I'm impressed by both stars. I think the standard of the match, the kicking and the defensive efforts are superb from both teams. I guess that both coaches will be happy, because when you start a final, you have unusually that five-minute build-up where you're introduced to the dignitaries before the match, you're out of the dressing room for longer than normal, and you can at times lose concentration in those five-minute periods. Neither side's managed to do that, and both have made very, very positive starts.
Webster, and here's David Tangata-Toa, just celebrated his 24th birthday, the big Rovers prop. That's the fifth. And Webster will again put the kick in. This one's going to go straight towards Wayne Price, but just forcing him to turn and chase back to his own try line. That ball held in one hand. And good chasing defence. Michael Platt has been a good recruit for the Castleford Tigers, signed from Rochdale during the close season. 13 tries already this season from Platt, the National League Young Player of the Year last year. And here's another recent recruit, Andy Bailey, on loan from Hull at the moment. Chased down, and the ball rebounds as far as the captain, Andrew Henderson.
It was a big decision from the referee, Billy. I don't know if the player knew too much about that. It came at him at such a speed.
And Henderson almost through the gap. He manages to evade the tackle, and he's still going. He's still not tackled. He is now by Dale Holstock.
I think they've got that wrong, Bill.
He's going to give the penalty here anyway.
I think it's been very hard done to the Kingston Rovers. Surely that kick, it was turning his body, and to me, the ball played the man. Bit of controversy, but they'll take the two. Phil, you mentioned that the build-up to a final is different from any other game. The nerves are jangling. All you want to do is hear that whistle, isn't it?
And both sides, well, they responded to it. I think they also responded, Steve, and why wouldn't you, to the atmosphere inside this ground. Maybe hard to sense at home, but it's really bringing the best out of both players. And the speed and opening of that match, this is the first break now in play after 5 minutes. Very quick opening for everybody involved.
Craig Hubie has been very accurate with the boot this season. 50 goals, 51 now for the second rower. And Castleford Tigers take a lead here. But Hull KR will be feeling hard done by that. Holstock, the man penalised for stealing the ball in the tackle.
It is very humid down here, and I must say that you look at the two sides, Phil. Hull Kingston Rovers, the pack of forwards, they're enormous, but they're also will be carrying a little bit extra weight. It must take its toll in these conditions.
You say that, and you would think it when you're looking at the players, but last week they seemed a quick, powerful, dynamic side. The way they put 72 points past Featherstone Rovers just goes to show what skill and speed they have in the team. And I hope we see some of that today.
QB with the ball for Castleford. Henderson, one of three Hendersons playing in Britain at the moment. His brothers Ian and Kevin in Super League action. Bradford and Wakefield respectively. Now here's Adam Watine. Had a storming game when Castleford beat Hull KR 32-26 at the Jungle back in May. That was a massive game, a great crowd, a great afternoon that was, and it looks like being another great atmosphere here at Bloomfield Road.
Well, already you've got an indication of how Castleford want to play. They go to that quick spread to the left-hand side. Brad Davis standing wide with options outside him, and that'll be a problem for Hull Kingston Rovers unless they manage to get enough players out there. Brad Davis, a major, major attacking weapon that Castleford will go to today.
Hull KR will get the penalty. Leroy Rivette applauding it for that just interference at the play the ball there.
It's a silly penalty to give away as well.
Tom Hockey, the culprit, former London Bronco.
They had them right under the pressure there and they just lacked the concentration.
So the pressure is off for Rovers. They have been under the cosh a little bit. Here is Dale Holstock, son of Roy, the former Rovers and Great Britain prop, who won the cup with Hull KR in 1980, a classic all-Hull final that recently celebrated in the play. In Hull, Hull Truck Theatre Company putting on a special production to commemorate that final, and Dale Holdstock's father was a part of that. And Hull looking for silverware this afternoon with the Northern Rail Cup. It's been a long route to get here, a bit like a rail journey these days for these two sides. And it's Rovers on the right track at the moment with Leroy Rivette. Ellis, they could be in here. The ball dumped back inside by Byron Ford. It's going to be a cross-field kick by Manson. That is a difficult one for Wayne Price. He's underneath that. The ball is loose and all sorts of bodies there. And Ben Thaler is asking the video ref to have a look at that schmozzle, well, just to see what the outcome was.
Whether the players were offside, had they got the discipline to just hang back, waiting for Manson's high crossfield kick? That's the most important aspect. They tried a good attack on the left-hand side, but Castleford's defence was up to what they threw at them. Here's the high kick deep into the in-goal area. There's probably three Rovers players and three Cast Tigers as well. Here's the kick going up, cross-field. I think probably from that angle they look to be offside. Kane Aparte perhaps, the number three in the white jersey. Seems to be the place. It's a tough one to call, isn't it? At the point of contact, he isn't in the screen.
Well, it gets plenty of height to this ball, and of course that gives them the extra few seconds, which means extra few yards. It is a dodgy one. This is going to be very dodgy. If we go to see if he's forced the ball down, then maybe this try will be given. Did anybody get to it? I'm not so sure. Andy Raleigh was very close.
Well, we've gone past the decision on whether he's offside. We're looking now for a clear grounding of the ball. I don't think there was a knock-on at that angle.
Ooh, I think that's he's Andy Raleigh's hand.
Yep.
Andy Raleigh's left hand has just got down on that.
But does he knock on before it? Ooh. And he does. Castleford fans, they're already
it's
on their
Andy
feet.
Raleigh. It's Kane Aparty's hand. Ah. Does it matter?
Still a knock on, no try.
So a let-off for the Castleford Tigers. Was it Andy Raleigh? Was it Kane Aparty? Well, it doesn't matter because it's disallowed by referee, video referee Jerry Kershaw. Eight minutes and 46 seconds on the clock and Hull KR denied. So still waiting for the first try here, just the 2 points on the board. Here's Adam Watine.
And he's been a handful, Bill, hasn't he, when he's taken up there. Three men, he's lost possession, but he's got to compliment the Rovers' defence. But he's been strong in the tackle. A little unfortunate there, I think, to come up with a fumble. He's wrestling, isn't he, trying to gain extra metres all the time. And he's lost possession for his team.
Well, this ground, Bill, is in absolute perfect condition for exciting open rugby league football. And I think that's what we're going to get.
Big tackle. Big Steve Crouch, he was. I beg your pardon, it's Dion Bird, of course, with that head guard. Webster, here's Holdstock. Penalty goes to Rovers.
That's the second one that Tom Hockey's conceded inside 10 minutes.
Just lack of concentration, Phil, and I think the nerves are getting to him. Not many of these players would have experienced the pressure that comes with a cup final.
It does, it takes a great deal of self-discipline. People use that word self-discipline, they think it's about not giving away penalties for throwing high tackles, but very often it's getting off the man, getting up, back into position as quickly as you can, not conceding the penalties that so often lead to points in rugby league.
Gareth Morton then will attempt to level the scores with this penalty, and the odds are on him kicking this, because since joining Hull KR from Borders Rugby Union, his goal kicking has been a key contribution to Rovers' sequence of wins. 51 goals in the last seven games for Gareth Morton, former Leeds Academy Grand Finalist, England Academy Tourist. And a very accurate goal kicker. Straight towards that far end of the ground, the open end, and the scores are level. Castleford Tigers 2, Hull Kingston Rovers 2.
You can tell how confident his teammates were in him. Not many of them set off to chase after he put the foot to the ball. They know how accurate he is and how good he is.
I think also, Phil, that what a wonderful tone of respect that the whole side, by going for a long-range 2 points, they obviously respect that this Castleford defence is pretty solid.
So we're back to square one. The score's level again. And the Rovers supporters getting behind their side. They're outnumbered here at Bloomfield Road today. There must be about 5,000 or 6,000 Castleford fans. And probably about 3,000 or so Hull KR supporters, but they're in good voice, those Robins fans. And here's Byron Ford, Cook Island international, who scored tries in four of the last five games. And Paul Manson now, vastly experienced a Kiwi. And Manson wins the penalty.
And you're spot on there. Bill, you've picked it right, because he knew exactly what he was doing. He made a real meal of this, virtually throwing himself in front as he was trying to play the ball, and the referee Benthala had no hesitation.
There's Dave Woods, the Castleford Tigers coach. whose main aim is to get the side back into Super League, but he'll know that if you win this cup, then you tend to stand a good chance of going all the way. Big hit.
Craig Huber knows how to put the shoulder to the man, doesn't he?
Here's Leroy Rivette. Tackled by Paul Hanforth and Andy Bailey. Manson, Webster now. Tangata Toa.
Three, quick guys.
He's tackled on that Castleford 20-metre line. Now they've got numbers out here to the left-hand side. Over Manson delayed the pass and got in a bit of a tangle with Jason Netherton.
We've just got to show again how strong Castleford are on this right-hand side in their defence. Craig Huber, Dion Bird, well, it took him even probably before he even had the man, just a suspicion.
And a delay for the injury to Jason Netherton in that collision.
It's always a problem when you create in a very short pass like that. That he was taken out before, not seen by the officials.
He's okay to continue. And here's Michael Platt. Okay, our fullback, the Tigers supporters appealing for a penalty. Johnny Hepworth now. Seen Super League action with the Leeds Rhinos and the London Broncos. Hockey. He's tackled by Holdstock and Tangata Toa. Now here's Adam Watine again, captain of the Cook Islands side, which won the 2004 Pacific Rim competition. Watine and a big favourite with the Tigers fans. Henderson for Wayne Price. Price, great stepping run from the Castleford Tigers winger. One of the most exciting players outside Super League. Davis, that looked majorly forward, and it was.
Good work by the touch judge. The man with the whistle didn't actually see from the angle where he was put, but the near side touch judge and got it right as well. It's fantastic to see the combination. Far too often we see throughout our game, Phil Clark, that the referee wants to take full charge, but he's got to use his assistants, the two touch judges.
About working as a team, isn't it? And they did that well on that occasion. I just thought an interesting play in that set of six for Castleford was when Henderson ran from dummy half. He found Price back on the inside. That's a dangerous play for Hull KR. And when Anderson, much like Kieran Cunningham for St. Helens, when he can get out of there, it causes problems for the opponents. It must be very early at set-up markers prevent him from doing that successfully.
Rovers go down the short side, and it's almost too short. Just managing to stay in the field of play was Andy Ellis. Ellis, this Derby-born hooker for Hull KR. Holdstock now. Almost away from the Tigers defenders, Bailey and Watine. Webster, little kick off the outside of the boots, and that could cause problems, but Steve Crouch is back there, and Crouch is nailed in his in-goal area.
Bill, what about the accuracy of the kicking we've seen on show in the first 16 minutes? Absolutely superb. In fact, better than much that we see very often in Super League. To trap your opponents in the in-goal area, almost creating a try as well for the Hull KR side. Great kick there, very close on the touchline. In fact, his head was probably pushed over it, but touchers chose to ignore that one.
It's right under the nose of Stuart Marshall with that red flag. In front of the Matthews stand here, we've got the Matthews stand, the Mortensen stand, the soon-to-be-built Armfield stand. Some great names from Blackpool footballing history, but it's a different sort of history that can be made here today. Loose pass there. Ellis and Jason Netherton just not clicking.
Bill, it's amazing in cup finals, people very often wonder what wins it and what loses it for team. It's very often the accuracy of the passing and the quality of the catching that determines who'll go on to win a trophy, because you can see just how closely contested these two teams are. Just a misdirected pass was a massively wasted opportunity there now for the red and whites.
So 17 and a half minutes gone and we're still level pegging, two apiece, a penalty to each side. No sign of that first try yet.
Again, a lack of concentration, this time coming from the big fella, Paul Manson. He's a solid standoff, that is for sure. He'll be an important cog in this whole KR side. Interesting to see that the way that the KR have got the two big fellas rally on the right-hand side, mixing it in with the centres, and they're using Netherton on the left-hand side. I often think that it can work, but sometimes it can confuse the centres who are already out there.
A lot of teams like to play, don't they, with almost two centres, a second row and a centre working together as a double-pronged attack. And I just feel as though the intensity is slightly dropping here now. The fatigue, there was no way that either team could keep that pace up for 80 minutes.
Crouch making good ground there for Castleford Tigers. And then it's taken on by Andy Bailey. And now here's Frank Wattin, an even bigger favourite with the Tiger supporters, because he's an even bigger guy. Now Brad Davis. Davis flips that ball on, and great defence from Hull KR.
Superb, Bill, that. Tom Hockey ran a great line, but the Rovers' defence said, hey, if you're going to come on it, you're going to have to pay the price.
And he did.
It's always dodgy when you play that very, very sharp ball.
The second man option just behind Tom Hockey. There you see the Castleford player, I think it was the fullback, Michael Platt.
But what a hit, though, by the standoff, Paul Manson. He's having a wow of a game.
And that's roused the Rovers supporters. Here's Leroy Rivette. Much travelled Leroy Rivette. This is his ninth club in what has been a pretty erratic career, shall we say. He's known the highs and the lows. That was a bit high, I think.
Well, change of direction from Jason Netherton just... I don't think Frank Wattin or Dion Bird like that, do they? When they're going up for the hit, they just want it straight forward. The left arm from Frank Wattin over the top. Again, though, it's that left-hand side, that left channel for Castleford, Bill, that they've looked more dangerous. Going out to Brad Davis and players outside of him. I'm sure they'll persist using that side to attack most.
The whole KR will know all about Frank Wattin. He was on their books last year and lost in the... this competition, in fact, against the Lee Centurions. And they're looking to make up for that. Michele Azu is on. Andy Raleigh, who's probably the most promising player outside Super League at the moment, a player who is being closely watched by Super League clubs and who hasn't agreed a new deal with Hull KR yet, which is pretty ominous.
Well, Michele Azu just came up with that handling error. That'll be a big disappointment for him. He really is an impact player. When he comes onto the field for the Rovers, he very often turns the game in his favour, his side's favour. Such a powerful runner.
Bailey again with the run. And Holdstock has got a knock. He's staying down on all fours on the halfway line. Almost through was Tom Hockey. Can Castleford find a little chink in this Rovers defence? The ball's gone backwards. Referee says play on. Crouch for Price, and Price trying to go on the outside, flicks the ball back inside, but he had a foot in touch.
An outstanding defence again there. It's that left-hand side of the field that Castleford have been successful exploiting. Leroy Rivette summed up his man and pushed him over. You'd see that his foot is already on the line before he releases the ball. Hence the reason why the touch judge puts his flag up, because the line in rugby league means that you're out of bounds, out of play.
It's obviously that the Tigers fully aware that they want to pinpoint. They feel that there's a problem on the Hull KR right-hand side. They are really pressing into that corner.
Problems for Hull KR because Dale Holdstock has had to leave the field. Obviously picked up a bang there. And Rivette is stopped in his tracks. Webster pops that ball up to Jason Netherton, and big Frank is there to lend support to Craig Hubie Morton. And there is a ferocity about the Tigers here. Michele Azu now, another popular player from PNG. Jamie Beauville. Ooh, that was a big tackle on Beauville from Andrew Henderson. And then Rovers with the kick, and Wayne Price deep inside his own half brings that one back towards the halfway line, but runs into the tackling of Dwayne Barker. Michael Platt with a scooting run, and that caught Hulkayor offside.
Bill, you just sense a try coming. I think maybe the fact that the Rovers side weren't able to get back onside with the referee is an indication that now maybe the power with which Castleford have started this game is starting to take its toll.
Well, 23 minutes on the clock, still haven't had a try here. Just a penalty apiece. Is this an opportunity for the Castleford Tigers to get the first try on the board? They're close to that Rovers line now. Brad Davis. Davis finds Hanford. Hanford comes back infield. He's tackled by Dwayne Barker, the former Leeds Rhino Barker. Here's Davis once more. Pops the ball off to Richard Fletcher. Fletcher is tackled by Andy Rally. Numbers on that left-hand side, the ball's popped up, but we won't get that first try because it's been bombed again.
Well, that's amazing again. Rovers did really well, Bill. They were outnumbered 4-3 when the ball went to Brad Davis, but somehow they managed to put enough confusion into the Castleford side. They couldn't find the man with the pass play. Too hard, ricochets off the chest and into the arms of Jonathan Steele, and he knows another wasted opportunity. We need to keep some patience, though, about their attacking philosophy.
Just get the feeling that the Tigers are gaining in confidence. Both sides were just trying to test each other out in the first quarter of this game. And it's not unusual with all the pressure of it being a cup final. And I just got the sense that the Tigers were now building upon it. Davis was coming in taking first receiver. It wasn't the best pass from Davis then, but there's obviously a lot of pressure being applied on the winger Jonathan Steele and the centre Kane Epati.
So Rovers with the head and feet at this scrum. Here is Kane Epati. And now Dwayne Barker. Barker legs pumping, almost making it to the 20-metre line. And Craig Hubie doing well there. Cass appealing for the knock-on. Well, they'll get it now because Rovers have spilled that ball. Oof. And they did well. Dion Bird did very well then because he was going the wrong way, wasn't he? And he reacted to claim that ball. Now here's Frank Watine.
Are they going to go
Manson
right
is
left
marshalling
again,
the troops on that line for Hulkayor. Davis. Davis out wide. Platt now. Platt trying to go on his own. He's tackled just short. Hepworth is there. Davis now. Davis will put the little grubber kick in. Hanford is chasing and Morton will get there to rescue the situation. So often those ricochet into the attacking side's hands, but on this occasion, Hulkayor came up with it and Byron Ford is away. Byron Ford, has he got the legs? He's just ankle tapped by the oldest man on the field, Brad Davis. He did that on that game in May between these two sides. He saved the game for the Castleford Tigers. He saved them again there because Byron Ford was almost away.
And the Tigers did remarkably well, Bill. Most of the players got back on side with the referee, more in fact than the Rovers players could get up in support.
But it's Hulkayor on the charge now. A let off at their end of the field. Can they make the Castleford Tigers pay here? Here's big Jamie Beauville, but they've spilled the ball. And anxiety.
The third handling error there from Ezu. And again, you just maybe a sense of desperation from both sides.
They're just too anxious,
to
aren't they?
Score too quickly, yes.
They're overplaying it.
I thought Castleford had built some great pressure, though, down at this end of the field. There's the kick. It ricochets off the post. And then the break from Steele. Both sides have got some speed, but if you just look at how hard the Tigers worked to get back, Byron Ford it was, scooting out of dummy half, just ankle tapped. No support alongside him.
So we're just catching our breath here. As you see that Bradford lead Lee by 12 points to nil in Super League. Meanwhile, we saw Dale Holdstock going off earlier on. I think we can catch up on his condition with Ben Pro.
Well, Bill, Dale Holdstock, the news on him, he had that bang on the head in that collision. Well, he was immediately withdrawn by Justin Morgan. Dwayne Barker sent on. Speaking to the doctor on the Hulkayor sideline, he's refusing to rule out Holstock's return to this game. So Holstock certainly could play a major part in this game.
Here's Frank Watine.
Not sure what went on here. That was the injury to Holstock earlier on in the game.
Hockey. Hanforth it was, let the ball back on the inside to Davis. Henderson, here's Hanforth again, and hoist that ball straight down the middle of the field, and Leroy Rivette is safe underneath that one.
Does he like those high kicks in finals?
Hasn't always been the case, Phil. Murrayfield.
He's made up for it so far today. He's been very solid at the back. He was pretty good on that defensive play out wide on the far corner near his own sideline. You don't see as much energy in the Hull Kingston Rovers.
Oh, they've lost that ball. They've lost that ball. Henderson's come up with it. He was the first to react.
It's killing this Hull Kingston Rovers side. The errors. The substitute, Mikaeli Azu.
Look forward to me.
He's come up with three errors so far. We just had another one there.
Fletcher, so close for the Tigers. Now then, is this an opportunity for Price? And he's driven back in the tackle by Paul Manson. He's been immense for the Robins so far. Davis, Platt, Webster up on him to close him down, but Platt manages to get the ball away. Back to Davis. Shenton is screaming for the kick. Shenton has got it, and Byron Ford manages to push that ball out. Now then, who got the touch there? The referee, Ben Thaler, comes across to consult with Mick Wilson, his touch judge, and he says somebody got a touch to it. Well, that was apparent, but whose touch was it? Oh, it was Byron Ford who put that ball out, and Cass will get the feed at the scrum.
I think that replay clearly shows that too, Bill, doesn't it? His right hand just knocked it out of bounds. And the pressure now built by the Tigers on this line, surely they must come up with a try.
Coming up to the half-hour mark, Davis almost away, Manson went high.
Big decision now, Bill, do they go for the two right in front? I think I would go for the pressure.
Listen. Yeah, you've gone high, right? There's no need, Jamie.
Pretty high. But Davis, as the game is going on, it's same play on. They're going to take the tap. Or will they go to the corner? No,
they're taking the tap. Fletcher looking for the try against his hometown club, but he's stopped just short, the former Hull man. Coming up to the half-hour mark, and Frank Wattine has bombed it.
What do we say about passing accuracy?
Well, it's a problem with the 17s. I've already mentioned the fact that Azu has come up with three errors. Now the 17 on the Castleford side. Frank Wattine has just come up with an amazing error. And to be a coach at any level, who'd want the job?
The ball did go behind him, though, didn't it, from Henderson. Whether it was meant for somebody else, Hulk need to get out of this area. I think the Castleford fans here have played their part in helping him with the intensity. Oh, mistake. No, it's a penalty.
Hands in there.
Well, I don't think that was going to help. Leroy Rivette got up after they got the penalty and then is applauding cheekily to the official. That won't help him. If it was a 50-50 ball, I know what I'd be doing.
Platt, the man penalised. So here's Andy Rally. Rally, with the 13 tries this season, has been an outstanding performer, joint top scorer for this whole KR side with Kane and Party. Webster now. Webster, little chip kick, and it ricochets nicely for Andy Rally. Great footwork from Rally. He's got a hand to it.
No try.
I think Andy Rally will get this one.
I think he knocks on,
Bill. I need to check to see if there was any obstruction leading up to the try. Right.
But a neat chip over, nonetheless.
Okay.
A little ricochet off the hand of Craig Hubie.
And because he's gone for the ball, everybody is onside.
Rally
being played.
Rally just boots that ball on.
It's a
Chas hat. Oh, I don't think he did. Oh.
Knocked on, no try. But
Dwayne Barker.
Oh, this is interesting.
That's a try.
Did it go backwards or forwards? Now then.
That's a Cass boot.
It went backwards. This could very well be a four-pointer.
Well, interesting play, Bill. Kick over on the third tackle, I think, from James Webster. Confusion there at the back, so well placed again, the kick in between the winger and fullback. Hacked on.
Then Platt gets a boot to it.
First one, and then
and
a second
boot. And it goes back.
Boot.
This will be T.O. Whiter.
Netherton.
He just wants to check whether it went backwards. It hits the forearm and the elbow. He doesn't get a touch to it there. He misses it. And then off the boot again. So the ball has played the man. The simple equation, as far as I'm concerned, is it'll be 4 points and a TRY on the big screen. Definitely comes off the Castleford boot, Phil.
Oh, no doubt, and I think that this should be awarded as a try. I'm unclear as to exactly what they're looking at. There's no try at that angle there, Steve-O. He certainly doesn't ground the ball, in our opinion, anyway.
Well, he's trying to see whether he gets a fingertip to it, but I think he misses it completely, yep. And therefore, that will be try time.
I think it'll be the first of the day, Bill.
Jerry Kershaw has the decision.
You see, the ball plays the man, so therefore, it can't be classified as a knock-on.
You'd have to say too, Steve, or maybe against the run of play, Hull KR looked like the side on the ropes, yeah, didn't they, for 5 minutes building up to this.
And they will look
the
back.
The penalty helped them get out of area, three good runs, and then that dangerous kick over the top set up this position.
Well, I don't know why they're waiting, it's got to be tried.
Is this the first try of the game? Oh, we're still waiting for the first try here. And Jason Netherton is denied that.
Well, I'm baffled. Well, I don't know about you two.
The verdict of video ref Jerry Kershaw is that it was accidental offside.
Well,
because Netherton was the culprit.
He'd know more than we would, Steve-O.
So, 31 minutes on the clock, and the first try is scrubbed off. Still two apiece. Now then, Panforth through the middle, Platt on his shoulder. Oh, how painful is that? Denied at one end, and Castleford cut them to ribbons at the other. And Michael Platt gets his 14th try of the season. And it was so simple in the end.
Well, it was all about speed, wasn't it? The speed with which they seized the opportunity. Came behind the middle of the field. Here's the no try at one end of the field. He's kicked on there. Comes off the Hull Easton Rovers player, travels forward before Dwayne Barker grounds the ball. But Hanford's speed through that gap. In that area, dangerously behind the play of the ball. Teams look to exploit it. And Castleford certainly have there with their first try. It's a messy play of the ball. And then the Hull Easton Rovers just stopped momentarily for that. There was no stopping the Tigers as they went for the first.
So relief for Dave Woods, because his side have really put him through the mangle in this first half. Craig Hubie adds another goal, his second success of the afternoon, and Castleford lead by 8 points to 2. Justin Morgan, well, yet to officially take over at Hull Kingston Rovers, but he's just seen his side denied at one end and then exposed at the other.
And I suppose it's an old sporting cliche, you have to take your chances in finals, and the Tigers have done that. Pressure really consistently on the Hull Kingston Rovers line for the 10 minutes leading up to that try, and the Rovers went the length of the field, had again a try disallowed. Byron Smith comes on the charge.
Oh, and what a charge it is from Byron Smith. But then, a rush of blood to the head, and the ball comes up for Andy Raleigh.
Well, there's an invitation. Go on, you get back into the game, Rovers.
Kane Aparty is tackled about 18 metres out. Bovill, Webster, straight up the middle, Webster. He is tackled by Craig Hubie. Rovers on the attack now, Netherton again. Here's Gareth Morton. Morton trying to use his strength to get to that line. They're just short of it. Four tackles gone. Webster. Webster finds, or thought he'd found, a little gap in the Tigers' defence. That's the fifth tackle. And Manson. Manson stepping, trying to offload, finds Michele Aizu. Michele Aizu. Well, he's going to get tackled. And they just ran out of options there. Did Hull KR.
Give Castleford some credit, Bill. They put some great pressure on the kicker when Manson was trying to get one in. And eventually then they got enough bodies around Izu, he couldn't offload to Webster. Good work there. They've all helped Byron Smith out with that that effort in defence. And you wouldn't back them going the length again here. They're showing some good speed with these dummy half runs back in that area, behind the play of the ball, Bill. Traditionally, a defender doesn't stand there. If you can get back in behind the play of the ball, you can make some good ground.
Crouch now. They have found another gap. Crouch couldn't get the pass away. He had Davis on his inside. But they're threatening again at the Castleford Tigers. Oh, they're screaming for the kick. Now, Ben Thaler saw that. Right under his nose, Dion Bird was taken out. The little chip kick, and Dion Bird was taken out there.
It looked like a penalty to us, Bill, didn't it? But Ben Thaler, again, he watched it. He could see what was unfolding. Pickering, that short pass there to Netherton. Come on. Dave Woods wasn't too impressed. He thought it was another penalty.
Jamie Beauville now, charging his side up just over that halfway line. Webster to David Tangatatoa. He's tackled just on the 40-metre line. It's the kick now from Webster. Trying to put pressure on Michael Shenton, but Shenton underneath that one very well indeed. Came over his shoulder, but he took it very calmly.
With that being repetitive, Bill, another great kick there from James Webster, just a metre short of the try line. And trapping Castleford down here, relying on these dummy half runs from the likes of Price. Still a great pace to this game.
Well, it's been an energy-sapping, nerve-jangling first 36 minutes here. And these two sides will welcome the half-time break. It's also a sweltering afternoon.
Well, like Brian Noble pointed out on Sky Sports on Friday night, which team are thinking about the break and which team are now thinking about scoring another try?
Leroy Rivette doing very well there. Got out of trouble nicely. The chase was from led by Dion Bird. Jonathan Steele, another former Scottish Rugby Union man, 5 caps for the Scottish Rugby Union side. He's played opposite Jonah Lomo in his career. And Byron Ford is nailed by Paul Hanforth. Ball and all, if there ever was one. Jason Netherton, Cass fans in front of us, bellowing for forward pass there. Off goes Paul Pickering. And Pickering couldn't find Morton. Morton with a look of Earl Crabtree about him there.
Certainly has. You know, it was a nice little play, I think, from Pickering. You saw that there was only two defenders on the short side, but neither the winger or the centre got where he wanted them to be. And maybe a missed opportunity. And a gifted one to Castleford, you know. Possession on a halfway, 2 minutes and a half to half-time.
Hulker, of course, without two of their regulars, Paul Parker and Phil Hasty, are out with serious injuries, and we'll be watching this afternoon. And the Rovers fans, of course, wishing them both speedy recoveries. Phil Hasty, a really nasty leg break he suffered. Henderson now, again they're on the charge. Hepworth, ball over the top, it's going to come to Price. Did it go forward? It went forward off a Hull KR hand. And it's 6 to go, but before we get that far, it's going to be a penalty, I think, to Castleford Tigers. Kane Partey, the culprit.
I think Hull KR a little unlucky, Bill, because I thought that was a forward pass before it touched the Hull Kingston Rovers player. He's not seen it that way, and a penalty now will go to the Tigers. Will they kick for goal, or will they go for the try?
I think they're going to go for the two. Wayne Price is on his feet all right, didn't disturb the hair. Kane Partey, well, was that the lesser of two evils? 2 points at the expense of possible six.
Right, possibly so. They've done well to defend that side of the field. You see the score update there. Bradford 24, Lee 0 after 26 minutes.
Craig Hubie made his debut in Super League at the age of 17 for the Castleford Tigers. And his goal kicking has been part of the Tigers' march to the top of National League One. He's kicked another one which could put them on course to success in this Northern Rail Cup final. They lead by 10 points to 2. Long way to go, though. And Hull KR looking forward to half-time, just a chance to regroup. The clock counting down towards the break. Just the one try then in this first half. Morton hoists that one deep into the Tigers' half, and Byron Smith brings it back. Relegation in successive seasons with Halifax and Castleford for Byron Smith, hoping for promotion this time, hoping for cup success this afternoon. Well, they're halfway there, but it has been a grueling half. The Castleford Tigers just edging it. As I say, just that one try. A couple of very controversial decisions, though, ruling out other ones. But in the end, it was simplicity itself, with Michael Platt posting the only four-pointer of this first half. Castleford ahead here at Bloomfield Road by 10 points to 2.
That in this heat, with this pressure, having made so many tackles and few errors to boot, that perhaps late in the game, Hokington Rovers just might wilt a little bit, and it could be the Castleford Tigers' day. However, there's a long way to go yet, 40 minutes before we know who takes home the trophy. But a thrilling first half, wasn't it? You know, we go to witness every year for the National League Grand Finals, and we are here for the first time for the Northern Rail Cup Final. And these teams from outside the Super League really do provide fantastic entertainment. Congratulations to all concerned. The Whitehaven coach, Steve McCormack, is here in the studio with Steve-O and me. We were saying that during the game, weren't we? Great advert for the game outside the Super League, this.
Yeah, it certainly is. I'm a big believer that we've got a great product outside Super League. I mean, Super League's obviously the pinnacle of our game, and rightly so, but underneath that, both National League One and National League Two, there's a lot of quality players, you know, a lot of quality games which happen throughout the season, and also well supported. So, you know, I'm made up that, it's, first of all, it's live on television. Secondly, the coming up with a game like this.
And of course, you're well qualified to speak because you've been on both sides of the fence. You were Super League with Salford, now you're Whitehaven, and rebuilding your career and hopefully bringing Whitehaven into Super League next year, because you haven't given up hope yet up there, have you?
No, definitely not. You know, there's a long, long way to go. We've got to go to Hull KR, and we've also got Castleford to come up to our place as well. But, you know, I think, you know, teams like Halifax and Doncaster, Rochdale as well, they're coming up with some big results. It's a good league with a lot of quality in there.
And these two sides are proving it. There's been some great action. There's been some controversial moments. We're going to come on to those in a moment. Castleford, though, I think they had all the pressure, didn't they? And so nearly, Hull KR came up with tries.
Yeah, I think Hull KR deserve a lot of credit for that. I think, as you said, they've had more or less all the field position, Castleford. I think Phil mentioned on commentary that the main plays from right to left, with Brad Davis trying to hit Tommy Hockey and Michael Platt around the back, you know, with a decoy pass. But, you know, all credit to Hull KR. They've obviously done the homework, James Webster and Morgan with that. They've watched a lot of videotapes, and I think Hull KR has played exceptionally well.
They've both played well, two great sides. Credit to their division, the National League One. And I must say, Brad Davis, Steve-O, what is he now, 106 years of age or something, according to some people, he has been outstanding for Cat. That chase back and the ankle tap, magnificent.
Without doubt, he's playing out of his skin. And yes, you're right, Eddie, I don't know whether he's as old as me, but he certainly is the elder gentleman out there. And how he got back was absolutely wonderful. But first 10 minutes, you knew it was going to be a hard scrap. And this was the first real opportunity that Hull KR had. No doubt about it. It was definitely a knock-on from Raleigh, no try. The video referee on that occasion got it right. Byron Ford makes the break. Now, this is the incident that Eddie is referring to. How on earth did Davis get back there? That looked 4 points all the way. And then controversy. Steve?
You say it's controversy.
I think it's controversy. Netherton, no try. It hits... It's. I think it's
kicked
by...
There's the knock-on.
I think the ball is kicked by the Castleford player. Steve, what do you think? It looks as though the Castleford player lashes out of it, so therefore it's kicked onto his arm. He's not playing at it, so it should have been play on. I think the video referee's got it.
I think it's a massive call. I think, as you said, the main controversy about it is who kicks the ball. Is it the Castleford player or is it James Webster?
Well, it looks to me as though it's a Castleford player. He's playing at it. That is as far as I've got to say.
But does he come off the arm and doesn't it go forward? Wasn't he making a play to put the ball down?
No, he wasn't, because the ball was propelled forward with a boot at such speed.
He couldn't do it. And talking of speed, beautiful break by Hanforth and good play by the fullback. That is what you're looking for. Not many opportunities. And I think that when you saw that game get in the last 5 or 6 minutes, there was a big problem in the whole KR side. They were very tired. They looked very much under the weather. I think the heat is affecting them. We know they've got a bigger pack. If they can come back, they've got to score exceptionally early in this second half. But I just can't see it. I think that the way that Davis is playing with his halfback partner, Hanforth, I think they're just taking full control. And I think they'll go on to win quite convincingly.
So Steve-O has changed ships at half-time. He was tipping Hull Kingston Rovers before the game. Now it's going to be Castleford's day. We shall see. We are watching Castleford Tigers for the first time this year on Super League, Sky Sports, of course, since they dropped out of the Super League at the end of last year. And we're watching a new coach, Dave Woods. We've never seen him before. Big man from Australia, big heart and big reactions. We love this. We love to see the coaches reacting like this. And see, he doesn't agree with everything that goes on. And he wanted a penalty there that wasn't forthcoming. He was furious about that.
Eddie, the game is all about passion.
It is.
And you've got to show it both on and off the field. He certainly does that.
Not every coach enjoys our cameras being pointed at them throughout the course of the game, but Dave Woods, fantastic, fantastic. And Steve, if you get back to Super League, watch out, because we'll be looking for you to do all your celebrations.
No, I've calmed down since then, Dave.
Have you?
I'm fine now.
No, you won't. When you get back into the big time, you won't. You won't.
Who knows?
We'll see. Right, Super League scores, current scores as the matches are unfolding. Later scores, these are: Warrington are ahead 8-2 against London. Bradford, 30 points to 6 against the Leigh Centurions. Oh, a massive trouble here for Widnes. They trailed by 18 points to 0 against the Wakefield Trinity Wildcats. And honestly, if Widnes lose that, I think they will be on their way to the National League One for next year. But Widnes fans, you ought to have a look at this Northern Rail Cup final. There is life after the Super League. They will know all about that, of course, themselves. Only been there a few years. They're the latest scores in the Super League. Here we have a great second half on the way. Castleford ahead by 10 points to 2 after the break.
What makes a cricket legend the world's greatest?
What a moment of history this is.
Speed, agility, strength, ability, the debate is on.
The world's greatest sporting legend, tonight at 8, Sky One.
Dad!
Well done.
Statistically, you're more likely to get arrested than change your bank account. Come into Barclays and get 0% interest on overdrafts, plus up to £745 worth of benefits. Changing is easier than you think.
Sales calls. Never a good time, is there? You have been chosen. Special offer. Let's talk about lagging. So BT has launched BT Privacy, a free sign-up service to help block unwanted sales calls with free caller display, so you can enjoy your privacy in peace.
Sign up free. Call 0800 121 8000 now.
Don't put me on hold.
Buying car insurance over the phone. It's all talk with those call centres. Click onto SwiftCover.com. We cut out call centres, so 70% of our customers could save, and you could get a quote in less than a minute.
What are you up to?
Just stuffing a chicken.
That's a coincidence.
SwiftCover.com. The Swift savings. Click, click, don't cluck, cluck.
I don't believe I'm to be relied upon for good judgment.
It's kill you or let you go.
Does he want to die?
Brand new Deadwood.
Next one is to your head.
Tonight, 10 o'clock, Sky One.
Blackpool for the Northern Rail Cup final, but next weekend we're back in the Super League. Wigan Warriors against Wakefield Trinity Wildcats is the live match Friday, Sky Sports 3 at 7:30, and Sky Sports 3 again on Saturday at 6 for Warrington Wolves against the champions, the Leeds Rhinos. It's half-time here at this great venue, Bloomfield Road, home of Blackpool Panthers and Blackpool Football Club, Castleford Tigers 10, Hull Kingston Rovers 2 at half-time. Great choice of venue this. Older members will remember Lee and Blackpool Borough in a Challenge Cup quarter-final in 1957. 20,000 were here to see Lee win by 24 points to 13. Who's going to triumph here? 40 minutes to go, then we'll know who's going home with the Northern Rail Cup. It's back to the commentators. Steve-O's up there alongside Phil Clark and first Bill Arthur.
Castleford ahead, but only just. Their last success of any kind in 1994 when they beat mighty Wigan to win the Regal Trophy. That was a big upset, and an upset you're still recovering from, aren't you, Phil?
Yeah, I was pretty upset at the end of the game, but the Tigers fans won't be if they can go home still winning by 10 points to 2 at the end of this match. And every indication probably in that first 40 minutes would indicate that they are going to go that way. The only reason that Hull KR really troubled their line was through a couple of kicks, so if they can put pressure on Webster and Manson, maybe they can cope with what the Rovers have got.
Hockey takes his side just over the halfway line. It's the Castleford Tigers in possession. Now his 37-year-old Brad Davis, that looked forward. But play continues with Michael Platt trying to run rings around the Rovers' defence. And then it's Byron Smith who puts a big kick in. It's not a bad one. It's down the middle of the field. And Byron Ford will bring it back. We haven't really seen just one glimpse of Byron Ford's blistering pace, but Castleford managed to ankle tap him to stop his progress. We haven't seen Jonathan Steele, but here he goes now, and he's caught Castleford offside. Steele quick off the mark there. Tigers too slow off the mark, or too fast off the mark.
One or the other,
or on the wrong mark.
I think it's Tom Hockey again. It's poor play really from him, though, not getting back in quickly enough with the referee. Is that the third penalty he's conceded?
Here's Andy Rally. Rovers really do need to get something on the scoreboard, or a try on the scoreboard, points on the scoreboard early in this second half, just to signify a little bit of a threat. Otherwise, Castleford will grow in confidence, but it's Rovers running confidently at the moment. Just the third tackle, plenty in the bag as they come down this short side with Leroy Rivette, then back infield to Webster. Pickering trying to go underneath. Webster again changing direction, pops the ball up. They're over the line. I think it's a try for Jason Netherton. Oh, he's not going to give it. He's not even going to look to the video ref. Netherton lost control.
Well, it's taking your chances. He's gone for it. Drops it just short of the line anyway. I suppose being so close, you have to have a go at it. Reaches out, but doesn't quite make the line.
And even the Rovers fans right over there underneath whom that incident took place conceded fairly rapidly that it wasn't a try. Looked it from this angle on the far side of the field, but Netherton again denied.
What was really positive, though, from the Rovers' point of view was how they kept the ball alive close to the opponent's line. Maybe we saw a real dearth of offloads in the first half from both sides. Perhaps the tension of the occasion leading to that, but Rovers now being behind probably do need to promote the ball a little more when they're in good attacking position.
Crouch is tackled just inside that Rovers half. Very nearly a fumble there from Johnny Hepworth. Now it's Byron Smith as they cross the 40-metre line. That's the fifth tackle. So Davis will look to turn the Rovers' defence. It's over the head of Jonathan Steele, and Steele under a little bit of pressure from Price. But in the end, that ball goes into touch.
You need dangerous kicks. Whenever you put the ball in, it needs to be a dangerous kick that puts pressure on the guy trying to get under it or get it close to it. Is it in the in-goal area? Can it be contested? Most of Kasovas today have been.
And it was a really good kick by the halfback Brad Davies. I think that we saw in the final 10 minutes of that first half, the two halfbacks, Hanforth and Davies, taking complete control. And it doesn't surprise me, I mentioned at half-time, Phil, that it looked as though Hull KR was a little bit tired just before they went into the break. And when you look at Paul Manson, he's made 11 tackles. He's out there to be creative, and yet he's having to do the work of the forwards. They can't do that as this game progresses.
Well, he's been helped, isn't he, with the penalty count going in their favour.
Let's catch up with the half-time news, see what the coaches have been saying. Down to the sidelines and Ben Pro.
Well, Justin Morgan, the Hull KR coach, he's been preaching patience in the dressing room at half-time. So there's no need to panic, wait and take the chances. Of course, they had that chance early on in the second half, but he thinks there'll be more to come. It's very humid and hot here at pitchside, and he wants them to control the game and take the fight a little bit to Castleford. Dave Woods, the Castleford boss, well, he sees speed as the key factor. He's looking for quick play of the ball to try and run Hull KR off their feet. And a particular mention, he wants them to close down James Webster. He sees him as the danger man for Hull KR.
Meanwhile, Craig Hubie is penalised for that high tackle, and Rovers have the opportunity just to make progress down the field out of the indiscipline. 8-3, the penalty count in favour of Hull KR as they go up the middle with Paul Pickering. Now Webster. Webster pops the ball up for Manson, or just clinging onto the shirt. It was crucial defence there from Tom Hockey, but it might not be enough. Andy Rally is over. What strength from the Rovers second rower. But he's gone for the screen. Well, touch judge was on the spot.
Well, why does he have to go?
No problem with that at all.
It did bubble, but he got control before it. This will be TRY. They will not be denied on this occasion.
Andy Rally will be relieved to make up for that missed opportunity in the first half when he dropped the kick in the in-goal area. The try awarded on the big screen. And Rovers back in the game. Probably helped by the fact, Bill, that Castleford have conceded three penalties in the first 5 minutes of this second half. It's helped Hull KR Rovers get back in the final. Ball came wide, just the strength and determination of Andy Rally. Nobody was going to stop him getting over the line. He got so close to it this time. Came on the ball, strong and hard. Brad Davies not strong enough to hold him in the tackle, and he does well to get his arms free and put the ball over the line for a very important try.
Well, Gareth Morton has been kicking so effectively for Hull KR Rovers since joining them from Borders Rugby Union that you'd put your house on him kicking this one. He's done that. And Hull KR Rovers close the gap to 2 points now. 10-8 in favour of the Castleford Tigers. Andy Rally's 14th try of the season.
And your mind has to go back to the high shot from the loose forward, Steve Crouch. It allowed Hull KR the position to keep the ball alive. It was a good build-up. Paul Manson burst towards the sticks, and it was well finished by Rally.
Of course, if it's level after 80 minutes, we've got extra time, 10 minutes each way, before we get to Golden Point. I'm sure it's so energy-sapping out here that the players would welcome, if it gets to that, Golden Point immediately, they're probably favour.
Some good confidence there from the Hull KR Rovers team, shifting the ball wide inside their own 20, trying to just displace the Castleford defence before going forward. Kearney Party getting up and over the 20-metre line.
Well, the red robin is bobbing along at the moment. They've come back, the fans are in good voice, singing the club anthem. And the tails are up. Robin's had tails, don't he?
Little ones, it's fluttering well for them. This back three, as Steve McCormack spoke before the game, they've been very important for Castleford. Shenton first with his run and bit of footwork, followed by Platt. eventually now back onto hockey, but Wayne Price being the complement of those three who's really helped in those early runs from dummy half.
Here's Byron Smith. Some good strong runs from Byron Smith since he joined the fray. Thumping challenge of Paul Hanforth by Jamie Beauville. Okay. Byron Ford retrieves that ball, then finds Leroy Rivette, and Rivette is away. Great run by the Rovers fullback, and Hanforth just manages to cling on to him. And I think Hanforth was just getting to his feet at that point when Rivette came running towards him. But they're still on the charge here. Oh, and that's a nasty tackle.
And the work between Rivette and Byron Ford was fantastic. Firstly, the linkage from the kick return set the charge for Rivette, and then a quick play of the ball, run from dummy half from Ford, and he's picked up and planted back on almost onto his head. He was spoken to by the referee. The concession of four penalties now, big problems. It's making life very difficult for the Tigers. Touch it, John.
It'll definitely go on report. It was a bad one by the fullback Platt.
Jimmy!
You know, and I often wonder, Phil, it always seems to be when it is a bad tackle, they take them over the horizontal and drive them down. It's as though it's automatic that they say, oh, we'll put this on report. Surely there'll be an official one day, he'll say, get off, sent off. I wonder. It might be the case for saying it was a gravity. And then they get to the point where you can't do anything about it. What are you supposed to do? Adjust and bring him back?
I don't think you'll probably ever see a player sent off for that, because at the point of contact, Steve, as soon as you hit with the shoulder, it's that instantaneous leg drive that takes the player up and then, well, he turns over and twists over. I agree with you, it's a dangerous thing. I don't think he intended to spear him into the ground, but once he had him up in the air, he couldn't really let go.
So, Morton to level the scores. He's got a big boot on him, as Gareth Morton. He's a Widnesian, but his 3 years in Scottish Rugby Union have brought back his twang. And the Rovers supporters in good voice, because Gareth Morton has levelled the scores. 10 apiece here.
Well, a more adventurous approach, perhaps. You just saw that little bit of confidence in the backfield of the play. OKR just prefer to move the ball around and just test this Castleford defence. Make sure that they're being honest in the middle of the field, everything coming up and prepared to work. Great break there in the middle of the field by Leroy Rivette.
So all the huffing and puffing we've had for 51 minutes and the scores are still level. Could we have extra time?
Well, it was the speed with which Castleford seemed to play that last 15 minutes of the first half that caught everybody's eye. All of a sudden, the speed seems to have come from the Hulkington Rovers team. Manson now takes on the defence, really spreading this Castleford's defensive effort across the full width of the pitch.
They're playing with a lot more adventure, Hull KR. A little bit of remiss in the first half, but they have stepped up a couple of gears. Shenton just taking his time to gather that ball. Big deep kick it was. Coming across the field is Michael Platt. Now Tom Hockey.
Well, they've just been put under a bit of pressure. I'm sure they want to just steady down here now. Get upfield with some good strong runs. Byron Smith takes it up. And again, put some quality on the kick and chase. Brad Davis trying to direct his troops. He knows he just wants simple go forward here.
Well, they've got to get that field position that they enjoyed in the first half. And they've got to make sure that this is a very good kick and chase. Wayne Price, one of the most experienced players out there, and he's still only 23, is Price. That kick too deep. Rovers restart on the 20. It is a lovely pitch here at this Bloomfield Road ground.
Might not feel that good, Bill, when you have to keep running from end to end, as these teams have done for this game.
Two relief!
Andy Hull, Jason Netherton is tackled. The Rovers really have lifted in this second half. They're making good yards. Dwayne Barker, that's a good run from the Rovers replacement. Pickering, Manson now. Manson, little dummy, and then took on the defence, but the Tigers defenders stood firm. Hockey again with the tackle it was. Kaner Party, little chip over the top. Steele is trying to catch it, he's got it. It's on the last, and that'll be the turnover, but Jonathan Steele almost got away.
Again, great quality from the Hull Kingston Rovers team, finishing the set, putting pressure on Castleford. It's literally going from end to end here now. See a lot of runs from dummy half, but such is the nature of this game. Both sets of fans trying their utmost here now to lift the team. Just force a mistake or something.
The Hull KR fans are outnumbered, but they're in better voice at the moment. It's the Tigers on the attack, though. Garmston with the tackle for Hull KR. Dwayne Barker in there as well. Andy Bailey. That's the fifth. They're on the 40-metre line in the Hull KR half. Hanforth.
Okay.
Scoots that ball through, a grubber kick. Finds Byron Ford. And you get the feeling that as these players tire, the likes of Byron Ford, Jonathan Steele, Wayne Price maybe, Michael Shenton might find a bit more space. Maybe this man as well, Leroy Rivette.
Well, look. The pressure now coming, isn't it, onto the wingers and fullbacks, really. I think that the rest of the team are having to do so much work in defence. I'm hoping for this quicker, speedier guys to just exploit a hole in the middle of the field and they can get through it. Big hit again there by Craig Ubi. I think he's been impressive. Reminds me very much of a young Lee Crooks. He's got great ability, natural talent, and I hope he can go all the way.
What an accolade that is. The penalty goes in favour of Hull KR. The man was held as he went for the ball. I think it was Steve Crouch on James Webster there.
Well, it's not going to plan. I think everybody, myself included, was perhaps thinking that the full-time professionals of the Castleford Tigers would perhaps overrun the Hull KR side, but it has turned around. And full credit, the rest at half-time. Often, Phil, they say a half-time halter can come at the very wrong moment. He appears to have done that for the Castleford Tigers. Still plenty of time to go, though.
Well, Gareth Morton has just returned from rugby union. He's brought rugby union back with him because he's going to try and kick this penalty from the halfway line. And the Castleford supporters lifting their side. It's an absolute cacophony here. This to give Rovers the lead. Morton puts his boot to the ball, he's kicked it. Hull KR ahead, 12-10, ahead for the first time here. What about that kick?
That was some quality, hasn't it? They've been quality all through this game, whether it be passing, catching, kicking or tackling. But one thing that the Castleford team will be most alarmed about is the fact they've conceded 5 penalties in the 16 minutes we've had in the second half and received none. So Hull KR's discipline has been pretty impressive. But if Castleford continue in that fashion, they won't give themselves a chance of winning.
Look at guys, Rovers with their noses in front then for the first time. Dale Holdstock is back. He's recovered from that bang he got in the first half. Good to see him back. He went off, in fact, to start his rugby league career with the St Helens Academy. Played for Swinton as well, had a good pedigree, Dale Holdstock, but now with his hometown club. There's a player down in back play, as it's a Castleford player, and play continuing, back to 6, says the referee, and there's a knock on there by Andy Raleigh, and Castleford will get possession.
There's problems for the loose forward of Castleford, Steve Crouch.
It's Craig Hubie, I think, who's down. And Craig Hubie
is
coming off. Well, that is a blow. Because Hubie has been outstanding so far. That's the incident.
Let's down, Mans. Get him, pal.
The ball went backwards. And Andy Rally was tackled.
Is that a turning point, Bill, in the second half? You know what? Handling error on the first tackle gives Cass a chance now to do something to bring big Watine back on the field. That's Adam Watine.
The sun burning through the clouds here. There has been cloud cover most of the day. Still been very warm indeed. But now the sun is out, it's going to hot up even more, and it's hotting up out there because Hull KR are ahead by 12 points to 10. At 20 minutes to go here, the Northern Rail Cup is at stake as Hepworth looks for a gap. He's well tackled though by John Steele. It's on the last as Hanforth hoists the ball across field, but it drifts out of play and into the building site behind the ground where the Armfield stand will soon take place, and almost reaches the site of the new Blackpool Casino, which will emulate something from Las Vegas apparently. So you'll be checking into that, Steve-O.
Without doubt.
And that kick, Bill, was probably the first poor one of the game, really. When Casaford needed to apply some pressure onto the Rovers side, the kick went too deep.
But who would you put your chips on to win this one?
Three release,
just 2 points in it.
Well, it's even money, it's red and black, because it's so tight.
Morton to Byron Ford. The Castleford Tigers screaming for a forward pass, but they're all pretty flat. Webster now will hoist the kick. Has got a great deal of depth on it, but it could cause a few problems. Rally is up there, and that'll be the turnover. It was on the last.
As a fullback, though, Bill, you don't want occasions like that too often now in the remaining 20 minutes of this game. And the ball's coming now, you want a nice, easy catch, but Hull Kingston Rovers, the dangerous kick and a good, enthusiastic chase. They seem to be the one winning this arm wrestle at present. Their hands on top.
You get the feeling, Phil, that if a try is going to come, it's come from deep within their own quarter. And that's where the likes of the wingers and the centres, they've got to be getting into dummy half, scooting away against tired legs.
Well, oh, there's a handling error from Bailey.
Frustration for the Castleford Tigers. Possession has been at a premium here. Dwayne Barker put his shoulder in there.
So you've got frustration from the Tigers and possible fatigue from Hull Kingston Rovers. They're looking to tire a little bit. Heat taking that out of them. They've lost one or two guys with injuries. As we see James Garmson just limp off the field.
It's taken its toll, is this game. Michele Azu comes on, and of course these two sides are going to turn their attention back to National League One and promotion, and they've got some big games coming up. I bet Steve McCormack in our studio is rubbing his hands as they batter each other, because I think Whitehaven have got to play one or both of these two in the coming weeks.
Well, we want competition throughout every league in rugby league. That's what these two sides are showing, and Whitehaven will do that as well. Great for the teams in Super League. Competition does no harm. And keep everybody on their toes. Two clubs, these here on show here today, heading in the right direction. Improvements on the field and off.
Here's Holstock now, across the field and then linking up with Manson. Here's Dwayne Barker, trying to spin in the tackle, but he spanned to the ground. Webster again, ball to the chest and pops it up to Andy Rally. Rally, great offload inside. Webster just was a bit flat-footed there. Holstock almost through. Webster again. Great hands from Rovers here. Manson. Oh, and the ball is knocked forwards. We'll take the first, says Ben Taylor. Whose knock-on was it?
Desperation there from the Castleford defence. It had to be. Full credit to the KR side. They kept it alive. They chanced their arm.
It was a Rovers knock-on. And Cass will get some relief now, but they have been under the cosh, haven't they?
Oh, the Tigers were on the ropes then. That was desperate. It felt as though a try for the Rovers. I don't know, just the energy, whether it would have just drifted away from the Tiger side. But again, they're continuing to hunt down the middle of the field. If you look, they're trying to send the quicker guys, but tiring forwards, using a bit of footwork behind that play, the ball where they scored the try in the first half. They're consistent that way.
And again, the ball is spilled, and this time it's Castleford committing the cardinal sin. And Andy Raleigh almost through there. He's left Tom Hockey on the deck. Hockey gets to his feet very gingerly. Mikaeli Aizu, definitely the wind in the sails of the Robins here. Oh, and Manson has, under no pressure, and a player is so experienced as Paul Manson now. The nerves are getting to him.
Well, Bill, why wouldn't this occasion get to you? It's absolutely fantastic event for rugby league. The atmosphere from the very kickoff has been superb. And I think now just the tension and pressure getting to both sides.
The thing is, Phil, it's things like that that can just turn the game. Castleford on the rack. They've been given a joker. Will they play it now and come back and score?
Well, this competition kicked off in February, in something like 80 games played in the Northern Rail Cup. Here we are with about 15 minutes to go, and it's still anybody's game. At the moment, Hull KR are ahead by 12 points to 10. That ball has come loose, it's been knocked on. Wayne Price furious with the officials for that decision, but Ben Thaler will give Hull KR the put-in at this scrum.
Well, we're seeing the number of handling errors increase as the game's gone on, hasn't it? The very start of the match was continuous rugby, but Castleford have failed in their last two sets to get to the end and put a kick in, and Hull Kingston Rovers obviously dropped it on the first tackle. So, just going into the 65th minute now.
Both sides are very, very tired indeed, and it's not surprising. The pace of this game has been superb. They really have thrown everything into it.
It's real bucket and spade here, weather here at Blackpool. And it's Rovers who go forward now with Andy Ellis. Here's Mikaeli Aizu. Good progression here from Hull KR. Manson now back in field to Leroy Rivett. Rivett trying to squeeze that ball out of the tackle. That's the fifth. The ball's popped up to Webster. Webster stabs a little kick in. Mikaeli Aizu gets it. It was on the last. It'll be the turnover. It just ricocheted off the cast man. He didn't know anything about it.
Well, you could sense the relief, couldn't you, in the Castleford players as soon as the referee blew his whistle for a turnover. Every time they get away from the line, they see the chances of staying in this game just increase. But some good speed in the Hull KR defence. They're moving up quickly off the referee. They're trying to condense the metres that Castleford commit. An important penalty, Bill. A very, very important decision. That's a turning point. 66 minutes. First penalty in the second half.
Meanwhile, let's get injury news from Ben.
Well, there's an injury in both camps, actually, Bill, and both are knee problems for Castleford. We saw Craig Hubie carried off the field earlier on. We've seen the influence of Morton's boot on this game, and Hubie, of course, the first-choice Castleford kicker. Well, his knee is strapped in ice, while for Hull KR, James Garston also has ice on the knee. Garston unlikely to return, but I'm told by the Castleford camp they haven't given up on Hubie yet.
It's the Tigers in possession. Steve Crouch, a couple of Robins' bodies on his back, and he gets to the Rovers' 20-metre line. Davis, Michael Platt. Platt is tackled.
Another good tackle by Paul Manson, Bill. He has been outstanding in defence.
Hepworth. Oh, almost the break from Andy Kane. Right in front of those posts. Davis now loops the ball out wide up. Byron Ford has got it. Watch him go. They won't get to him. Kane is chasing him. Ford is celebrating already. Well, he might. Oh, how cruel is that? Byron Ford with the celebration. And a celebration that started 40 metres out. And Rovers have finally managed to get a man free, and that man was Byron Ford, and when he gets free, there is no stopping him.
Well, all great wingers are full of confidence. He shows his confidence. He goes for a great catch in the air, takes off from both feet. And as soon as he picks it up, the coach knows there is nobody on the field will catch Byron Ford. He knows it as well. He sees Dion Bird behind him, gets a left arm up, has a wave to his friends in the stands, has a wave to the ones behind the post, and puts it down, knowing that's an important 4 points, which will certainly turn into six and require the Kasavad Tigers to have to score twice.
Well, he's excited about it, but if I was the coach, he'd get the biggest rollicking of all time.
Oh,
because
yeah.
It's in these conditions, it's very, very hot, slippery on the fingers. He's celebrating, and I've seen it happen so many times. He would be the biggest fool on earth if he dropped the ball here.
He did before.
It has so many times.
Well, Portland predictably has kicked the conversion, and Hull KR ahead by 18 points to 10. He's an exuberant character, is Byron Ford. Cook Island international, he's a very good basketball player as well. And there was a bit of Harlem Globetrotterness about that, if you can have trotterness.
I think you've got to allow some people to express themselves, and that's his personality. You've got to let him play that way and probably bring the best out of him. Good kickoff, it's gone too far, he's touched it!
Oh. All he had to do was just leave it. Cannot believe this.
Andy Ellis, what was he thinking of?
Well, it's very rare you'll see anybody wearing a number 9 come up with an error like this.
Hookers Union there, uniting. That's a very liberal approach from you, Phil. I commend you on that.
Oh, Bill!
That's done it.
That's very liberal as well.
Yeah.
That's too a liberal. Chance.
Andy Bailey has perhaps seen the black and gold ribbons being taken away from the trophy. Just over 10 minutes remaining of this game. It's not beyond their grasp, but when you come up with an error like that, how on earth do you try to lift your side? Not easy.
So Rovers regain possession.
One, clear.
Leroy Rivette is tackled, and Andy Kane just gives him a little bit of afters. Morton now.
Would you be looking for the 1 point now, Phil?
Well, they have three players who've got one for them this season. They do like that approach. Holstock takes it up to the middle of the field.
Well, James Webster is calling the shots out there. Soon to be coach Justin Morgan is on the sidelines. But Webster, a very, very experienced character, the scrum half. Plenty of appearances for Parramatta. The Rovers' big signing, and Webster is poised.
No, it's not.
It's Manson, and Webster throws himself to the deck because he was in the line of fire.
Well, it had more class to dive to the ground than I'm afraid the kick. It was a shock. But good tactics.
It was
I've been impressed, Phil. Mikali Azu, when he came off the bench in the first half, came up with three errors early in the tackle count, and he has worked hard and not come up with any in the second.
Well, it's very hard for us to gauge what the coach says at half-time, but it seemed as though whatever was said in the Hull Kingston Rovers dressing room set the right sort of tone, didn't it? They had an expression when they were in possession, and yet they had control when they needed it. And I guess Justin Morgan perhaps deserves some credit for that.
Bailey copped a shot in the chops there from Jamie Bovell, I think, in that last tackle. Castleford, though, in possession, and they need to do something creative with this possession if they're going to get their way back into this game. Kane with a little kick, and that was brave by Kane Epati, because the feet were flying there. Here goes Steele. Middlesbrough-born Jonathan Steele, but grew up in Scotland and now back in his home county and looking forward to making a career in rugby league. That ball went forward all.
Lack of concentration there.
Here's a chance. They're going to get benched about four times, the Tigers. I need to score in two of those.
Well, that is a sin. You're in full control. 8 points in front. It really should have been up the jumper time and then kicked right into the corner.
They could have done with that one pointer from Paul Manson.
I suppose they can't look for one man to just score an individual effort. It needs a bit of teamwork, probably some offload here. As you see, two charges individually by the Tigers. They need some support with the ball carrier.
Hockey was isolated there. Davis. There are some weary bodies out there, but Kane is not one of them. Kane has made the break. He's got support. Oh, he didn't find the man. He had men outside him, but he couldn't get the ball to them. But the chance is still there for the Castleford Tigers. Davis fires the ball out. They're in here with Johnny Hepworth. Hepworth will score.
And you go back, Bill, to the lack of concentration from the dummy half. He just lobbed it forward. They gained the possession. You can't write them off. That's a good try.
We've seen some quality today. Quality line run by Johnny Hepworth. Back against the sliding defence. Took a good pass from Brad Davis. And there with his kick from Craig Hubie, whether it goes over or not, they're back in with the most exciting 5 minutes of the season so far.
Well, Craig Hubie has come off the bench to try and kick this, and he's recovered. And Castleford are recovering. It's Castleford Tigers 16, Hull Kingston Rovers 18. Oh, hold on to your seats. Never mind the big one just down the road. This is a roller coaster ride if ever there was one. Hepworth's try, Hubie's conversion, and Rovers amble back to the halfway line. It's a hair-raising experience, this.
Certainly is. Now the pressure, I suppose the pressure really is on the Hull KR side.
Well, they need to keep their nerves, the Hull Kingston Rovers. Maybe Castleford Tigers need to chance their arm. They've got just under 6 minutes to try and level the scores here. They're just 2 points behind. Off they go again. It was the skipper, Henderson, with the run. And now it's the Tigers with the tails up. And it's Rovers defending desperately. Here's Big Frank.
They're That's looking the fifth here now, tackle. Some pressure on this kick, Bill. I don't think they're looking to score from it.
Davis. It's charged down, and it's well gathered. Good work from Andy Ellis.
It's important Hull KR, Bill, don't just think they've won it. If you very often see a team do that, they don't run with the intensity and pace, don't get far enough downfield, and mentally they switch off. They're waiting for the hooter.
David Tangatatoa. So Hull Kingston Rovers, just 5 minutes away from some silverware. Their last success was winning the plate against Hunslet at Wembley a few years ago, back in the 90s. Well, the Northern Rail Cup might not be one of the big ones, but it's been a stepping stone promotion to promotion for the previous winners. For Huddersfield, for Salford and Lee, it's always been a good omen. And maybe this is a rehearsal for the National League One Grand Final. You never know, I'm sure Whitehaven are going to have something to say about that. Meanwhile, Castleford Tigers have the ball back. Wayne Price takes them forward about 10 metres. And now Hubie on the charge. Tangatatoa trying to drag him to touch. It's a penalty. And I tell you what, Ben Thaler, you can see why he's been getting good raps in National League One, because this has been a hot afternoon. There's a lot at stake. Okay, there's been a high penalty count, but he's kept a lid on things.
Well, he's helped for what's been a fantastic game from the start. The whole day's been a success. One team will only go on successful on the scoreboard. Davis is looking for him. Andy Kane, I thought, was instrumental in this mini comeback from the Tigers. Can they get the ball to him again?
Well, Andy Kane was not in the original Tigers lineup. Pratt, oh, ankle tap by Morton. Vital intervention, but they're still on the charge here. They could be in. Hockey, I think it is. But just short of that line, is this the winner for Castleford? Offloaded, Henderson managing to get the ball back. Is it back to six? They're keeping it alive. Frank Mateen
Clinic. Move!
Nerve jangling. 3 minutes to go. They could be in here. The ball is out wide. Oh, they spilled it.
Knock on, feel the play.
It was Shenton.
Oh, Bill, that was so close. The play there, they went wide. Fantastic defence from Hull Kingston Rovers to deny Shenton. Was that the last chance, or is there more in this game? Still time on the clock. That stops for a moment.
Well, Justin Morgan has yet to officially take charge here. He's still got his job at Toulouse to conclude. But he's already got a taste of the passion that there is for rugby league in National League One, and the passion that there is in these two famous old clubs.
Well, Hull Kingston Rovers will just want as much distance as possible for these five runs. Kearney Party now gets them up to almost the 40-metre line. But the speed in the Castleford Tigers, Bill, gives them a chance whenever they get possession here. Price, Shenton and Platt, those back three players, they can find some linkages together against this tiring Rovers defence. They have a chance of going the length, whatever distance.
But it's under 2 minutes now. Under 2 minutes. As Webster hoists that one deep towards that Tigers try line, and Michael Platt is underneath it, but that's a good chase from the Rovers.
Well, they've got six tackles here to win the game.
They're just 2 points ahead. They're clinging on here, Castleford Tigers, the National League One leaders. Are they going to lose two games in a row, beaten by Rochdale last time out, 17 points to 16. They're on the losing end here now. They're trying to salvage something, trying to win this Northern Rail Cup. Oh, and Henderson has gone without the ball. Could that be it? We're into the last minute almost.
I think it very well could be. Great tackle from Jamie Bourville, just forced possession out. Clock stops again now.
It's Andy Raleigh who's down.
Get the ball off him.
I could almost have sunstroke, it's been that hot here this second half.
Rally is back on his feet. The clock restarts and it's counting down towards a Rovers victory. It looked as though the Castleford Tigers were heading for glory. They led 10-2 at half time and were in a position of control then, but a great second half fight back by this whole Kingston Rovers side to take an 18-10 lead. But Castleford have pushed them all away here. Rally, try scorer for this Rover side. Oh, they've gone without it again. Still time here, the last 10 seconds maybe, but they can't get away. It's going to have to be a kick chase, is it? Watteen now. Watteen, the ball out wide to Price. Price is going to have to chip and chase that one. If Party goes back, that is it. Hooter sounds, and Justin Morgan and the whole Kingston Rovers camp celebrate their first glory for so many years. The Rovers and Rovers supporters, unfortunately, not heeding the requests to clear the field. They're on and celebrating, but what a great comeback it has been by this whole KR side. And the Castleford Tigers players are on their knees after a fantastic effort. So it's Hull Kingston Rovers in their third National League Cup final. They've lost the previous two to the Huddersfield Giants and to the Lee Centurions, but they've got it right this afternoon, only just. But what a fantastic effort from these two sides.
Oh, that truly is. Remarkable game. Wonderful skill, full of excitement. People come to Blackpool for some pleasure. Just the Castleford fans are going home in some pain. But when they look back, they've witnessed a marvellous occasion in rugby league. A fantastic game, played at the very highest level. Just sadly, one team had to lose. But Hull Kingston Rovers, the deserved winners of the Northern Rail Cup final.
Well, the Rovers fans, thankfully, are returning to their seats, still celebrating a fantastic victory. And what an introduction to the British game. Well, he's played for Wales as Justin Morgan. He's still the Toulouse coach, but he's due to take over at Hull Kingston Rovers when he leaves that job. He's now with Ben.
Justin, you managed to remain calm throughout that game. What were your emotions like?
Oh, I'll tell you what, fantastic game of football to watch, fantastic game to be involved in. I thought both sides played exceptionally well today, and due credit to Castle that they put a mighty performance in. But to our guys, no credit goes to me about this game. It's James Webster and the crew. They've been fantastic over the last month, and they thoroughly deserve this, and certainly the fans deserve it as well.
You were behind at half-time. I think patience was the watchword in the dressing room. But the lads certainly did you proud in the second period, didn't they?
Yeah, definitely. And when we spoke at half-time that, let's not overplay ourselves a little bit. I thought we got a little bit excited when we got down there. We need to ask some more questions and build a little bit more pressure. We certainly did that in the second half and, obviously it was good enough at the end.
Now, you've been, as a club, OKR, been here and lost twice. How sweet does that make this success?
Well, obviously, very, very sweet, obviously. And obviously, they've been promising so much potential for such a long period of time as well. So, to get those other two losses out of the way and obviously to finally win one. And, to credit to all the fans, they've been waiting a long, long time for some silverware for the trophy cabinet. So, to those guys, thanks very much for their support for over the years.
Well done, Justin.
Thanks, mate.
What's your reaction to that? Win.
Oh, I think it was a fantastic game. We stuck in so well, especially after the disappointment of the two disallowed tries first half. I thought we really worked hard to stay in the game first half after they scored towards the end of the first half. And second half, I thought we just saw so much character to keep coming at them and eventually wore them down.
And a metronomic boot as well.
Yeah, this good run's going at the moment. I hope that keeps up, but I'll just see where that takes us.
And what about for Hull KR as a club? As I said to Justin, you've lost this twice. Does that make this all the sweeter this time?
Yeah, I think it does. There's a lot of talk during the week about the fact that we lost it twice, and this time we want to make it our turn. And just the build-up to the game, the training, it was so intense. We were really switched on, and we just really felt like today was going to be our day. And thanks, we made it third time. Lucky for these spectators that have come out and watched us today.
James. I know you handed over the coaching roles a little bit to Justin today, but you must be very, very proud at this moment in time.
Oh, very proud of the boys, been on a winning streak of eight now, and, we had a bit of trouble. Obviously, Harvey left, and, it was in our hands, and all the boys stood up well, and, we backed ourselves, and, today we got the fruits, didn't we?
Was it a help, do you think, having yourself on the field as well as Justin on the sidelines?
Yeah, Justin's been good this week, obviously he's an experienced coach. You can see why Toulouse have done so well. He's helped me out this week. He's done the off-field stuff where possible, and I can just concentrate on playing.
And of course, from losing this twice in a row as well, it means so much to the people of Hull Kingston Rovers and the supporters.
Yeah, obviously it's been a long time since some silverware's come back to Hull. For either Hull teams, and today I think the boys, we were under the gun at the start, and we all stuck solid. Half time we spoke about, the game's going to turn for us. They threw everything at us in the first half. They only cracked us once, so we're confident at half time, we're confident all week, and hopefully going to get on to bigger and better things then.
Well, a fantastic occasion for the National Leagues, a fantastic occasion for Hull Kingston Rovers, of course. They have won the Northern Rail Cup final by the narrowest of margins, really, just 2 points. And we heard from Gareth Morton. It was his kick off halfway that won it. And there's a famous former Hull Kingston Rover, Phil Lowe, still very much concerned with the club, former Great Britain team manager as well. And these current crop of fans, they came here as the underdogs. They were beaten on the 15th of May by Castleford in National League One, but they go home tonight with the spoils, and it will be silverware for Hull Kingston Rovers. And if previous years are anything to go by, Phil Lowe and everyone at Hull KR and Justin Morgan, the new coach, could well be in Super League next year, because the three previous winners of this trophy have gone on to win the grand final and claim a place amongst the elite. Brad Davis had a great first half, faded in the second half. It was his long ball out wide that produced one try, an interception try for OKR. And that was scored by the winger, Byron Ford. And here is the man of the match. Well, he was player coach until the arrival of Justin Morgan, and he has led from the front today. James Webster, the captain of Hull KR, goes home as man of the match from a thrilling and pulsating cup final. Absolutely breathtaking for these people. Glorious weather, it's been roasting hot, and now the sun has come out. The sun shines on rugby league, you see. A full house here. A lot of the Castleford Tigers supporters obviously making their way home. Quite a few have stayed just to see their players go up and receive their losers' medals. We have watched enthralled here in the studio, Stephen McCormack. The league, National League One, is alive and well. It's a fantastic competition on the evidence of what we've seen.
Yeah, it is. It always has, as it always will be. I think the standard's improving year in, year out. And anybody who's not seen National League and turned on the television today and watched that final, both sides slugging it out. You know, some great players in there, you know, nip and tuck all the way. And, you know, to be honest, both sides deserve a lot of credit for what they've done. Hull KR took the spoils and, you know, deserve it at all.
I suppose the problem for people who only know that Super League exists in this country is the fact that Lee came up from the National League One last year and they have struggled badly, haven't they?
Yes, they have.
It's a big problem to prepare for Super League next year when you only know in the middle of October you're going in.
Yeah, I think you're right what you're saying, but you know, Lee's been highlighted. You know, previous seasons, Salford's gone up, Huddersfield's gone up, Widnes have gone up and finished halfway up the table. So it is a problem because you don't know when you're going to get promoted. You can't recruit players early enough. But, you know, I'm a big believer. I know there's reasons for and against it, but if you take promotion and relegation away from the sport, I think it kills a lot of it.
That's very true. Castleford, they were in Super League themselves last year. They've lost a cup final. They were allegedly, Steve, going to walk away with National League One this year and come straight back to the Super League. I think they know now that it is not going to be an easy ride.
No, without a doubt. No, first of all, I'd like to congratulate both teams. It was a sensational game. I thoroughly enjoyed it. And I know that the Castleford players and their fans, they'll be somewhat dejected, but they shouldn't be, because they have taken part in an exhibition of rugby league football that had absolutely everything. There were some wonderful big hits, some nice late tackles that was, you know, prevented tries. We saw Davis in the first half, what looked like to be a tackle, but a try, should I say. But when you look at the fact, just before half-time, Hull KR looked out on their feet. The two half-backs of Castleford, Hanforth and Davis, were controlling things. And then all of a sudden, the half-time break came at the wrong moment for the Tigers, and it all turned around. And it was Paul Manson and James Webster that took control. It's a funny old game, Robin.
It is. Philip Hindle is there on the far side of the screen, and he is shaking hands with all the Hull Kingston Rovers players at this moment. Philip Hindle of the Castleford Tigers Club, but he is president of the Rugby Football League this year, and it is a bitter, sweet moment, I suppose, for him. Sweet in the fact that this has been such a success, this final today, but I would imagine very, very bitter, because he would like to have been shaking hands with his Castleford Tigers. But not to be. 2-point winning margin, and now James Webster, who has already been named the man of the match and gone home with that trophy, will take home the biggest prize of all from Miss Heidi Mottram, managing director of Northern Rail. And the Hull Kingston Rovers are the Northern Rail Cup final winners of 2005. They've waited a long, long time for success like this, the Hull Kingston Rovers fans. They won the Charity Shield in 1985. They were dominant in the game at that time. They went on to appear at Old Trafford in the 1990 Divisional Premiership Final. They allowed a big lead to slip, going down 30 points to 29 to Oldham, despite having won the second division title that season. They won the Yorkshire Cup on 7 occasions, the most recent being in the 1985 defeat of Castleford, strangely enough, 22-18. They were crowned Yorkshire League champions in successive years in 1925 and 1926, and they won the 62 Eastern Championship final against Huddersfield. But this is the sweetest moment of modern day. They have been out of the elite since 1993-94. Steve McCormack, I know that you have high ambition at Whitehaven as well. Hull Kingston Rovers, they could easily kick on from this now, as three previous winners have done.
Yeah, possibly. I hope not, obviously, but no, I think today just belongs to, obviously, OKR because of the way they've played. And, you know, they've come into this game as underdogs. Castleford's, you know, swept everybody in front of them so far this season. The performance OKR's put in today has been absolutely tremendous, but as I said before, you know, there's a lot of teams. Castleford now is under a little bit of pressure now. They've lost a league game, they've lost a cup final, and it's how they respond to that. And, you know, all the other teams in the National League, it's proven that every team's capable of beating each other, and it's going to be a tremendous end to the season.
Just caught a little glimpse. There he is, Leroy Rivette, with his arms up, swaying from side to side. What a moment for him. Four tries against London in the Challenge Cup final in 1999. Man of the match, Lance Todd Trophy winner. It all went very sour for him after that, and he's come back to this.
Yeah, it certainly is. I mean, he's had more clubs than Tiger Woods. He's been around the traps. He's certainly... And I think it's great to see guys who are prominent and they know they've still got it. OK, there are bad times. We all go through it in life, but it seems to come up against you in sport more times than not. And he has dug deep. I thought he had a very, very good game, especially in the second half. I know James Webster, the captain, fully deserved by his performance in that second stanza, but the two second rowers, Andy Ralley and Jason Netherton, especially Ralley, they're running out wide, and it was just the combination. They looked a little bit lost in the first half, but as I mentioned before, once you get your two halfbacks working together, Manson and Webster did that. A little bit quicker play of the ball. They started to shift it out wide and gave the opportunity of the centres, Party, Morton, and of course those two second rowers. Absolutely superb bounce back.
It's been a fabulous game. It has been a wonderful advert for the competition outside the Super League. Castleford and Hull Kingston Rovers gave us a thrilling final, and Hull Kingston Rovers won it in the end. We will reflect more on this victory for Hull KR and what it might mean to a famous old club when we return. 18-16, their victory. And we'll also have all the Super League final scores for you as well when we come back. Let's just wrap up the final score and the way it happened here at Bloomfield Road, Blackpool. Castleford 16, Hull KR 18, a full house, over 9,000 here. And Hull Kingston Rovers take home the spoils. We've heard from the victors. What about the vanquished? The Castleford Tigers coach is Dave Woods. Here he is with Ben.
In a strong position.
Yeah, we blew it again. We didn't play the way we should have in that second half. We didn't play the way that we asked. Once again, decisions just not going our way. And 50-50 calls, and they were getting them all. And even when they weren't 50-50, they were getting them, you know. So it's one of them things, I suppose. We're just going to have to regroup now and work hard next week and get stuck back into it.
And the objective now shifts to qualification for Super League. May have lost today, but that's obviously still the number one priority for 2005.
Yeah, it definitely is. You know, it always has been our goal this year and our number one priority. And, you know, just to see the fans that we've got here and, you know, it's just disappointing, you know, that we wanted to make sure that we tried to get a trophy back for them, and the boys did their best. They hung in there right till the end, you know, and just didn't play smart, and that's the way it goes, I suppose.
Disappointed, Dave Woods. Why not? Bradford Bulls have beaten Lee by 58 points to 12 in the Super League. Warrington have toppled the London Broncos 26-14. And oh dear me, Widnes have lost to the Wakefield Trinity Wildcats 44-18. That will probably make Wakefield safe. It could send Widnes down. Let's check the table after round 21. Here we go. Leeds on top by a point from Saints. Seven clear of Warrington now, who regained third spot from Hull, who won last night. Bradford tucked in behind. London on 20 points. And the race joined behind them. Wigan, Huddersfield, Salford and Wakefield only 4 points behind the top six. Widnes and Lee. Lee are gone, there's no question of that. Widnes, it will be very, very difficult now. These people won't be worrying about that, Hull Kingston Rovers supporters. They have won the Northern Rail Cup final. They have beaten Castleford Tigers, who this time last year were members of the elite of the Super League. And it's a great day for Leroy Rivette. And if Well, if past history is anything to go by, Hull KR now have the springboard to push on and claim a place in Super League, because over the last 3 years it was Huddersfield and it was Lee and it was Salford who won this trophy and then went on and won the grand final at the end of the season. We've had Steve McCormack with us all year. Every time I say that, we've had Steve McCormack with us all afternoon, and every time I say that, Steve grimaces, because you were so close last year. You want to get into Super League as well, but that was a wonderful advert for the National League.
Yeah, it certainly was. You look at you know, the quality on show there. You know, I know James Webster took the spoils as far as man of the match, but you know, Brad Davis, Michael Platt, you know, played some great stuff. Henderson first half was superb. Both sets of forwards, you know, in this intense heat as well, had great games. Michaeli Azu, his second spell, you know, could have been very easy for Azu to, you know, to just want to dig himself into a hole after his first spell, but second spell was superb. And overall, as you said, I think it was a great advert for National League.
It was, and wasn't it remarkable, Steve-O, that the non-full-time side, Hull Kingston Rovers, they were the team that I thought finished the stronger.
I think it surprised everybody. You know, I said at half-time that if they go on with it, Castleford, then they would win quite convincingly. But they really dug deep at Hull Kingston Rovers, and there are often times when, you know, it can go against you. Brad Davis, who had a superb game, it was a long pass. They were fighting to get in front again. But this fella, well...
Well, we love the celebration, Steve-O.
Yeah, but celebrate after you put it down. He would have been what we call in Australia a real goose if he'd have dropped that ball. It was a game-breaker, but look at this. Lack of concentration there from Ellis. And this gave Castleford the opportunity. All they had to do was to card it down. And Davis, well, he certainly put up a beautiful pass there for Epworth. And as it turned out, there's not many players, not even in Super League, will attempt from the halfway line. But Mr. Morton did. What a signing this guy has become. Took the advantage, no hesitation. He said, I'll go for it. Everyone looked a little bit shocked, including myself. But when it sailed over, as it turned out, that was the difference between the two sides.
Turned round the form that was shown in the National League earlier in the season. What do you think it will do now, Steve, to Hull Kingston Rovers? Will this be the fillip they need?
They possibly don't need a fillip, because they're playing exceptionally well before they came into this game. I think it's 7 out of 7 since we beat them up at Whitehaven. But as you said, you know, winning a trophy, confidence breeds... you know, breeds confidence, and their ability-wise, it's never been in question. Justin Morgan's going to come in, he's got a good side to work with. But as I said, it's how Castleford react, it's how everybody, you know, around them react. And you know, there's a lot of rugby to be played, but as you said, they probably, you know, made themselves favourites to get there.
I tell you what, your 51-0 victory against them 8 games ago looks pretty good now on paper, doesn't it?
I'll take it again when we go down to Hull KR, yeah, that's for sure. But no, they're a good side, and as I said, you know, National League has got a number of good sides in there, but it's going to take a good side to beat them.
There's a lot below Super League, is what you're saying. You know, we see Super League week in, week out. The viewers at home see it on Sky Sports week in, week out. But behind the Super League, great stuff coming up.
Yeah, I honestly believe that. You know, I didn't know what to expect when I went to National League One from Super League. You know, it was the unknown to me. And you know, I think a lot of people outside of Super League don't know what's on show there. And I think it's shown today. I think it's shown in the grand final that underneath Super League, you know, there's life after Super League. There's some great entertaining rugby. Some future stars in there. A lot of young players have played out there today. You know, players like Michael Platt and you know, other players like that. You know, Paul Pickering, who came on for Hull KR at 9, Andy Ellis, as you said. You know, there's a lot of quality players who if given the opportunity, can step up into Super League.
Absolutely. It was terrific. A great advert for what happens outside of the Super League. And, well, we're going to be at the Grand Final again this year, Steve-O, so we'll be looking forward to it once more, because that's another wonderful occasion.
They never seem to let us down, but, you know, I know people say I'm boring. A lot of people say that I keep saying it, but it is the greatest game of all. Simple as that. Full stop.
OK, let us tell you now what is still to come today here on Sky Sports. Right now on 1, the cricket is continuing as Durham take on Warwickshire. Then at 8, it's live football. Benfica against the Premiership champions Chelsea. Here on Sky Sports 2 next, boxing from the United States, Bernard Hopkins defending his world middleweight title against Jermaine Taylor. And there's live golf from the BC Open. Don't forget live Super League this coming weekend. Wigan Warriors against Wakefield Trinity Wildcats. That will be quite a battle. Sky Sports 3, Friday at 7. And a big, big test for Warrington. Warrington against Leeds, Saturday at 6, is also on Sky Sports 3. Today, though, the whole occasion belongs to Hull Kingston Rovers. Congratulations to the Robins. Thanks to Steve McCormack for being with us as well. Been a pleasure having you. See you next time. Bye-bye.